In preparing for an interview, take a few moments to think about it. That sounds silly, but a lot of people wing it. And I have a feeling all of you have as well. And I have too. But just taking a few moments, a few days ahead of time to think about the interview that's coming up really goes a long way. Because I find that it's sort of, as I like to say, it starts composting. You know, why are we having this person? Why are we, what do I want to know from this person? And I often will, and this is especially when I was doing television and doing a weekly show, I jot down a few questions. It's not a, you know, a legal pad or something. But then that's a starting place to keep coming back to and jotting down more notes. A really important thing, and this really transcends television and radio, whether you're doing an interview show or a news show or a documentary, try to avoid too many questions in which the answer is a number. Viewers don't retain numbers and lists as well as stories and ideas. You know, the numbers can go in the newspaper in a graphic or online, but for television and radio are really human-to-human kind of media, and so you really more want to, I mean, if there's a really big, impressive number, if there's, you know, 95% of all people believe this or something like that, or, you know, how many people are at the University of Southern Maine, maybe one or two big numbers, but, you know, you really don't have a discussion about data. It's not really good television or radio. People tune out. So that's a bit of advice about questions. This is, the third one is something that I did when I did Maine Watch, but to be honest with Maine Calling, I don't have enough time for most of the time because we do a program every day and we have two or three guests most days. But I'd call a guest ahead of time. I wouldn't let them know I was pre-interviewing them because then people are on guard. I'd just say, oh, hey, it's Jennifer from public television. I'm so excited you're going to be on the show. Do you have any questions? Do you need directions? Have you done television before? Let's say we're doing a show on whether there are cougars, and I mean the wild animal in Maine. I'm thinking one because it popped a wildlife biologist. You know, hey, let me ask you this, Warden. How long have you been trying to figure out if they're cougars? You know, I mean, you just start kind of asking them questions. And you'd be surprised when you ask somebody something ahead of time when they don't know they're being interviewed, how many times they'll tell you something really interesting that you never would have thought to ask them on the air. And then I jot that down. And I just note to self, this is really interesting. Or note to self, when I asked him this question, he said he didn't know. And so, you know, you don't do the whole interview, but sort of engage him. I learned the hard way not to do that right before. Don't have your interview come 30 minutes early, ask them a whole bunch of questions, then put them in front of camera. One thing people tend to say is, oh, as we were talking about before. And then the other thing is that people tend to say things really fresh once, and then they don't say it really fresh again, which leads to something else that's not on this. I make it a rule not to talk about the subject that we're going to talk about when the interview subject arrives. So the person comes in for Maine Calling, and I say, when did you fly in? You know, are you staying in Portland, or are you driving up to Bangor? Are you, oh, you know, you have kids in college too, don't you? You know, I talk about anything except the topic that we're going to talk about, because, again, people have this tendency to say, oh, as we were just talking about, or, and even if they're trying not to, they still do it. So that's one of my little rules with myself. So when you do the pre-interview, I make some little notes to myself. I did say that in my list. Okay. And then I kind of, you know, maybe somebody said something in the pre-interview that made me want to do a little more research, and I'll look something up. But the day of the interview, I write, read over the questions, but don't memorize them. Put them in a logical order, starting with a broad question, and then relax and forget about it until the interviewer walks in the door. Interviewee walks in the door. So those are my sort of preparing for an interview tip. My notes or thoughts about interview itself. What I said when I first sat down, you set the tone for the interview, and most people are kind of nervous to be on TV or be on the radio. And so if you're kind of formal with them, if you're kind of trying to be really impressive and buttoned up, that's just going to make them more nervous. Just be yourself, you know? Maybe even be a friendlier, livelier version of yourself if you have to, you know? I explain as well as I can everything that's going to happen. I don't know why people don't. I have had so many people, just happened to me on Monday, the House, the Senate Majority Leader told me he was on CNN and that they hooked him up and they just started asking him questions. They didn't explain anything. I hear that over and over again about the networks, and I just don't understand why they would do that. You know, they just hook someone up, say, stand by, and then start asking him questions. Do you want your show to be bad? I don't understand. But, you know, I find that if you explain to people, and what I say, I have this whole spiel I do with Maine Calling. The show's an hour long. It's in three parts. We go to two breaks. We're going to take, you know, I'll just talk with you for until the first break. And then after that, we'll take calls, listener calls. If we get a random call that has nothing to do with the topic, don't worry about it. I'll handle it. You know, and you can just see people's stress levels going, shh. You know, they just want to sort of understand what's going to happen. One of the lines I like to say, and it's true in my case, I don't know how hardcore, I mean, you guys are interviewers, but I say, this is not AM talk radio. No one's going to call you and yell at you. This is public radio. And you can see people go, ah, you know, it's, you know, explaining to people how it goes is just very helpful. When I would do television, when I do Maine Watch, I'd say, look at me, pretend the camera's not there. If you really, really, really want to be advanced, you can go from me to the camera and back and treat the camera like a person. But really, just if you look at me, it's going to be best. I used to have this line that say, if you look right into the camera, you're going to look like a politician, you know, and it was always got to laugh when a person was a politician. But, you know, I just, you know, I just sort of tell them how it goes. And, you know, that person over there is the floor director, and, you know, and sometimes I'd take them in the control room and say, this is, meet everybody. And it just the more real you make it and the less sort of secretive you make it, the better people are. So the next section is what I really, really have come to believe is my philosophy, is that you're there for the audience. You're there for your listener and your viewer. My thing that I don't like in interviewers is when interviewers sound to me as though they're very impressed with themselves and that they are trying to impress the person they're interviewing. It's not about, I feel like it's not about me. It's about my audience. And so the whole time I'm on the air, I'm thinking about what would the listener want to know? What should my follow-up question be? If I were sitting in my car listening to the radio or in my couch watching television, what would I want to know? And everything comes from that point of view. And to be honest, that's kind of liberating. If you sort of get rid of your ego and just try to really focus on what the listener, the viewer wants, sort of a lot of clutter goes away. Are any of you guys old enough or lived in Maine long enough to remember Bob Elliott on Channel 6? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, Bob told me one time, when I started Channel 6 in 1994, I was given the desk across from Bob Elliott, one of the great honors and privileges of my life. And one time he told me, Jen, you got to get rid of the self-consciousness. Just let it go. Shake it off. It's just in your way. And it was as though a light bulb went off. And he told me something that was just profoundly true. The more self-conscious you are, the worse your interview is going to be, the worse you're going to be. And you know, I think we're all sort of raised to try to be a certain person, be a certain way. And, you know, in high school and college, we give these presentations in front of class where we're judged on diction and grammar. And the sooner you get rid of all that, the better you're going to be. And so it's all about the audience. Ask the questions your viewer wants you to ask, not necessarily the questions the interviewee wants you to ask. Follow-up is something's unclear, you know, when someone, acronyms, unless the acronym is CIA, FBI, or I'm trying to think of the...
LSD is one of
Yeah, LSD. You know?
I was listening to Hair last
night. But, you know, with very few exceptions, if someone uses an acronym, just stop them and say, oh, you mean the Drug Enforcement Agency. You know, I mean, it sounds like a silly thing, but you're advocating for your listener or your viewer when you do that. Again, don't worry about trying to look smart. Keep the interview moving. Another liberating thing is ask short questions. It's easier to ask short questions and you get better answers. So, how often have you asked a question and you start and you turn this way and you turn this way and then you're stumbling over yourself and you're thinking, where am I going with this? I've had to train myself, but it's easier to ask short questions. And if your interviewee is rambling, it's okay to interrupt. Erwin Gratz taught me when I started at public radio, he said, it's the funniest thing, Jennifer, when you start talking, they stop. You know? And most of the time it works. Sometimes it doesn't, but that's what the pod is for. And then don't be afraid to ask the hard questions. I read years and years ago when Katie Couric took over for the Today Show, the person who was executive producer at the time, Jeff Zucker, I think it was, told her, you can ask anything you want, and this will date the comment, you can ask anything you want as long as you ask it like a lady. Now, somebody wouldn't say that now, but the point is, if you are polite and civilized and you are warm, you can ask anything. And I found that to be true. Yesterday I had the author of the new book about the North Pond Hermit on the show, and he was fired from the New York Times about a decade ago for fabricating a story. I had to ask him about it, so I just asked him. You know, he knew the question was coming. He answered it. I asked him a follow-up question, and he moved on. You know, sometimes it's kind of scary to ask tough questions. You just do it. And you don't do it in a mean way. You don't have to scold someone. You don't have to yell at them. You don't have to berate them. Just ask the question. And then finally, listen. And what I wrote, I really believe. If you're a curious person and you're engaged in your interview, it's hard to go wrong. And, you know, you're all here because you're curious, I'm guessing, right? So that's my summary. Questions? Yeah.
Do you pick your own interviewees?
So we have a team. There are 2.5 of ours. We have an executive producer, me, and a halftime producer. It's sort of a continual conversation among the three of us. Yeah. So some shows I've set up entirely myself, and some I haven't at all. And I mean, I know what the topic is. I've been in on the discussions about whether it's a good idea to do that topic, but I'm trying to think. Tomorrow's program I set up, Friday's I did not. So Friday, I know that the topic is women in brewing in Maine, but I don't know who the guests are. Yeah, I may know them when they come in because we've done some brewing shows before. So, yeah.
What's your take on interviewees asking to see the questions before the interview?
So, that's interesting you ask. Most of my questions are from the public, so I say to them, I don't know. I don't usually do that. What I usually say, and this is the truth, I say to them, I usually prepare my questions right before the show. So I can't share those with you now because I haven't written them yet. I can give you a general idea of what I'm planning to ask. And I did this just Monday. We had legislative leadership. Instead of having the Speaker of the House and the Senate President, we had the House Majority Leader and the Senate Majority Leader. And on Friday afternoon, the Senate Majority Leader's assistant asked what the questions would be. Not quite that specifically. And I said, Chris, I haven't written them yet. I said, but I can tell you, I'll probably ask about education funding. That's big in the news. I'll probably ask about the governor's State of the State address. I'll probably ask about the supplemental budget and opiate addiction. But I'll be preparing that morning. But just kind of just generally saying what I'm thinking about, was fine. That's really, you know, what she wanted to know. But I've never written out questions, submitted them, gotten them approved, had them sent back or anything within an interview. I don't do that, no. No. Go ahead.
So that hermit guy who knew the question was coming, just because that's kind of an elephant in the room?
Yeah, it was even in the press information that we got. He was, he knew his reputation. He knew what his reputation was, so he...
So was it that you prepared that question ahead of time?
You know, it's funny. I did actually write that one down word for word before I went on the air because I wanted to ask it well. And if something's touchy, I will spend a little more time crafting a question that's... an open question, but a question that's direct, you know, a combination of... One of the things I'm always telling my kids, because I think this is great advice in life and not just in interviews, is to make questions as open as possible. You know, don't say, why on earth did you do that? Say, why did you do that? Or, you know, just... so I want it to be an open question, but I also want it to be a very direct question. You know, how do you answer those who are skeptical about your work after what you did, you know? And I am a little more careful in crafting questions that might be more sensitive. But having said that, if I'm doing in the middle of a program and something pops in my head, I'll just ask it. I don't care.
Along with that, sort of the other side, have you had guests come on saying, I will not talk about this, this, or this?
If someone were to say that to me prior to a program, I would probably not have them on my program. I'm trying to think, remember if there's been a time. It hasn't happened in a long time, knock on wood. What I used to get sometimes with Maine Watch is that people wouldn't appear together. And it was never on a topic you would think. It was never on the big, fiery topic that was really controversial. The most difficult show to book, if my memory is correct, was we did a show on coyotes. And I guess there's a lot of strong feelings about the people involved in the two sides in the coyote issue, and whether coyotes are killing deer or whether coyotes should be allowed to thrive. And that was it. But that caught me by surprise because I was also booking shows that week on, you know, really controversial initiatives, and people are fine with that. They knew each other. They'd been on other debate stages together. So go ahead.
Kind of a complicated question. I was wondering about, do you get the quality of the answer you get from someone? Does it depend on the tone in which you ask it sometimes?
I think so.
Manipulate your tone to get like a certain response or a tougher question, you have to...
Sure. So I'm not one of those kind of reporters, but I do know reporters who, you'll see them do an interview and they'll ask one nice question, one nice question, one nice question, and then they'll ask a zinger. And they'll do it intentionally. I have even seen a reporter who turns to his camera operator and does a wink, like this is going to be the one, you know, and that's not my style.
I was kind of getting to, you could have a tough question, not sugarcoating it, but you know, like the tougher ones are going to be a little bit more difficult maybe with an answer. Are you a little more gentle? Or,
you know, I wonder if I am. I don't know.
You have an even tone. I mean, I feel like I know you because I've been hearing you on the radio for so long.
So the woman who hosts the show that's a lot like mine in Vermont, Public Radio, we got to meet and went out to lunch. And she said that her friends say to her, I always can tell when you're going to ask a really hard question because your voice goes up and you get really nice. and so she's done it for a long time. And I've never had anyone say that to me. So I don't know if I do that, but I'm sure it's possible, you know. It's not that common. I mean, I'm just, you know, if you're having a dinner with somebody and you ask them something tough, you just ask it. You don't, you know...
There are tactful ways to ask, and
right.
There are more.
Right.
But I think you have a reputation.
Ask it like a lady.
Right.
Wow.
But, you know, just ask something respectfully. You're not saying, I think you're a bad person. You're saying, I'm going to ask you something that a lot of people want to know because it's controversial. You know, people get that. They're not appearing on a TV or radio show if they don't get that.
I think you said earlier, don't ask the question that the interviewee wants, to just let them tell their story.
Not necessarily.
Think of your audience and ask their question. But on controversial issues, your audience is very split. If you were interviewing the president of Planned Parenthood in New England, one group wants you to ask questions about how much good they do with health care for women, and another wants you to push on how they feel about how she feels about abortion.
So you ask
both. How do
you
navigate those kinds of situations?
You ask both. You know, I start and say, what exactly does Planned Parenthood do? And, you know, I wouldn't say, what good do you do for women? Because that's a leading question. I would say, what services do you provide? And I actually probably wouldn't even ask that. I would know what services they provide. And I would say, you know, on your website, you say you provide this service, this service, this service. What do most people come for? How many abortions a month do you provide? How many other places in Maine provide abortions? Those are number questions, as I asked you. What's the climate like now compared? One little trick I often ask people things, if I suspect especially they've done something for a long time, I'll have asked them ahead of time, how long have you been head of Planned Parenthood? And if somebody says, I know that's not the case with the director of Planned Parenthood here, but let's say she said 20 years, I would ask, how has what you do changed in the last 20 years? An open-ended question, opportunity to say just about anything. You know, oh, we serve 10 times as many people as we used to. Oh, we don't get the funding we used to. Oh, it's just really hard to always have to have an armed guard in the lobby. That's not the atmosphere we want to provide. You know, again, an open question that's based on finding out a little bit of information about her first. So, go ahead.
What is the point where you feel comfortable interjecting in an interview, particularly if you have something that's verbose?
That is the big question.
Interjecting,
interrupting when someone goes on and on and on and on. It's funny because I'm trying to be better at that. I'm trying to be better at cutting people off earlier. And I've gotten criticized a couple times for that. You know, I think for every one person who's upset when I cut someone else, there are 25 people who are glad I did. So, you know, you have to use your instinct, you know. If you're sitting there and you're sort of thinking, hey, it's time, you know. Yeah, you know, and if you're looking at them in the eye and you're engaged and you just jump in, it doesn't feel like you're interrupting, you know. It's little.
You try to make conversation.
Right. You try the best you can. Don't say, okay, enough with that. You're going on and on. I mean, you know, there are other ways to do it. So, yeah. And, you know, I'll say things to people. What I do during debates, I don't do it during interviews as much, but I will say, you know, I try really, you know, if somebody is two sides of an issue, I'll say beforehand, I'm going to try really hard to keep this fair. And so if I feel as though one of you is going on and taking more time, I will cut you off. And so they kind of have that in their head already, that they're not going to try to take advantage of the situation. So in debates, we used to time debates at public television and public radio, and it was easy because the red light came on, and so I cut them off. But this last time around, we didn't time them. We didn't time our answers. We had someone in the control room keeping track. And I let them know that. I said, you know, we're not going to have a hard and fast time, but someone's going to be keeping track, and they're going to let me know. And if one person's going on more than the other, it's going to feel to you like I'm feeding more questions one way or the other. I mean, again, transparency, being really upfront, this is how we're doing it. So, and I didn't have anybody through all the primary debates, main callings, or the regular debates, nobody, including the referendum, nobody complained about feeling like the other side got more time or more. Because right at the beginning, I said, this is what we're doing. You know, it's a little different. It's more casual than we've done it before. But there's someone in the control room keeping track of how much time each of you is getting. So, and people seem to appreciate that and get it. So,
you're a very public public figure, you're well known. Does that make you circumspect about voicing your own strong feelings on controversial issues outside of your broadcast interviews?
I don't think, see, I'm a journalist, so I don't think I ought to. I don't put political signs on my lawn. I'm not registered in a political party. I absolutely don't talk about my personal issues. I don't talk about my personal feelings about things on Facebook. You know, I posted a picture of my daughter getting ice cream at Red's when it was 12 degrees outside. Yeah.
Does that extend to your family?
My husband knows how I feel about things. A lot of things, how do I say this? My husband knows how I feel about things. My kids will be rolling their eyes right now and saying, my mom always has to tell me both sides of every issue. You know, one question turns into a lecture. It happened today in the car with Julia, my daughter, trying to explain to her why some people might feel some way about an issue. She just couldn't understand how people would see the other side. So I think they could tell you how I feel, but they could also tell you the other side. Yeah.
Go ahead. What interviewers' shows do you listen to and admire? And I, in particular, there's two that I tend to listen to a lot, and I was curious about those, if others like Terry Gross and Krista Tippett.
So, it's funny. I don't usually get to listen to Krista Tippett, but I had a very early morning drive on Sunday morning, and I heard her, and it was so fun because I thought it was terrific. I really admire Diane a lot, Diane Rehm, who just retired. I don't have cable television at home, so I can't really talk about that. I like the PBS. I like Charlie Rose, and I loved Diane Rehm. I think my style is very different than Tom Ashbrook's. I actually, to be honest with you, I don't listen that often because I'm preparing for my show at that point in the morning, and so I have the classical music on because I get too distracted by listen. I can't listen to On Point and prepare for my show at the same time. So, I'd say Diane Rehm. I do like Terry Gross a great deal. I rarely ever get to do cultural programs. I do a few, but you know, it's a different kind of interview. But what I like about Terry Gross is that she follows my rule of she doesn't try to sound smart or, you know, you don't get the sense that she's beating herself, like, look at how great I am and how many people I know. She's gentle and like a regular person on the air. Yeah, so.
Maybe this should be the last question and
do an interview. Well, there's one back there, right? Back there? Yeah, go ahead.
I was going to ask you, is your show edited a lot? And do you ever really disagree with your director, and how do you resolve it?
So I do a radio show now that's live. Okay. So it's not edited at all. When I did Maine Watch, it was a little bit. It's funny, my director and I almost had code with each other. We would try to tape as live. We would say, we want this segment to be about 12 minutes. And he would count me down to 12 minutes. And if I kept going, he would know that I'd already, in my mind's eye, thought there was a section that was bad and was going to need to be cut. And we worked together 6 years. After a while, he knew what segment because he agreed. You know, I mean, it was usually obvious. You know, somebody had a coughing fit or somebody just kept saying the same thing over and over again. I'm sure you all have had those interviews where someone's sort of in a loop and they just keep repeating themselves. And so, it's funny you say that because we really tried to do as live, but we sort of had a little bit of a code. We would not do a 30-minute interview that became 12 minutes, but we might do an 18-minute interview that became 12 minutes. But we'd be making that decision almost like on the fly, you know. So, if that makes sense. When you work with the same people over and over again, you get to know each other. And, you know, he'd say, 2 minutes, 1 minute, you're going long, aren't you? You know, that's what I'd be hearing in my ear, you're going long, aren't you? I get it. So it was kind of fun. He was a very good director. Yeah. Yeah.
So would one of the Access producers like to volunteer to be the guest on Jennifer Rooks' show here tonight?
Matthew, producer?
One of the producers who's Matthew, did you?
Sure.
Sure. Okay.
This is Matthew Francis.
Okay, great.
And he has a show, an interview show that he does here.
Okay, what's the topic of your show, Matthew?
It's Diversity Dignified, and we address transgender issues.
Okay, great. So I'm going to break all my rules here because I would have prepared. I would have watched your show. Yes. I would have some idea of what's going on in the news today. Oh, you're not hiding your wire. So, Matthew, tell me again your last name.
Francis.
Okay, so let me think. So if I would have watched the show. I would have sort of done, if we're going to talk about transgender issues, I would have done something really sophisticated. I would have gone to news.google.com and typed in the word transgender to see if there was any big news that I missed that in the last few days that I would, be remiss not to ask about. So I'll just show you some open questions. Matthew, why did you decide to be a producer for community television?
Well, I did because in August 2015, I had been invited to Augusta to speak out the names of some trans folks who had been killed for being who they were. And truthfully, I just had an alarming thought, like, what if it's me next year? And I thought of this as an emergency and that we needed to normalize the situation and that this might be a great forum to do so.
How did that lead to a television show? Did you just knock on the door down here? And
no, I had met my friend Tom Handel at a mixer and just kind of spontaneously came up with that idea. And lo and behold, he works here, and so we went from there.
How do you find your guests?
Wonderful, interesting. I find them, they come to me, now they ask, sometimes they even demand to be on the show. And other so they've been some community folks, and then there's even been some nationally renowned folks.
Well, let me ask you a question that some of you were asking me. You're talking about a very personal, very sensitive topic. Mm-hmm. How do you prepare for your interviews?
I do similar. I do the research. I usually have coffee with them, try to get a feel for where we're going to go. I usually have a topic in mind, and so that's how I approach it. And then it's improv, most of it.
Are you transgender yourself?
I am.
And do you share your story when you're on the air, when you're talking with them? Is it a personal conversation?
It hasn't been. I've been the one to ask the questions and draw them out and kind of keep the story on them.
Right.
But lately I have been hearing a lot of people like, I want to know more about you.
Right.
So I've been,
I'm sure.
Yeah, doing a little bit more involved.
So do you ever pose questions saying, well, when I told my parents I did this, what about you? Or do you don't pose them that way? Or
no, I haven't done it like that. That's a good idea.
Oh, I'm not trying to give you an idea.
It's a great idea.
I was just wondering. Well, it's interesting because there's always that, and I have that conflict, how much do you talk about yourself?
Mm-hmm.
And I think there are some listeners and viewers who do really want to know,
mm-hmm.
And then there are others who kind of roll their eyes, oh, Jennifer's talking about her kids again, it'll be a show about education, and I'll say, well, my daughter, blah, blah, blah. And so you do kind of have to figure it out for yourself. But I bet you have a following that would be really interested in.
I do have a following. I love
more.
It. Yeah. Tom did just interview me for my own show, and it's being aired right now.
So. Oh, really?
Yes.
As of right now?
So, yeah.
Okay. Okay. Yep. So you guys, you see, like, I asked really broad questions. They weren't yes or no questions.
No.
They didn't have numbers. I looked you right in the eye. I pretended they weren't there. It sounds like it's, also obvious, but you all know that it's harder than it seems when you're in front of a camera. Yeah.
And I feel like I could just share everything with you.
Oh, thank you. But, I really am interested. I really want to see your show now. And And I think that's part of the key, is to make yourself interested. And you all are choosing your own topic, so you are anyway. Every once in a while, I'll get a topic that I think, oh, gosh. But I just make myself be interested in it, you know. And so, I mean, we did the tech show today. I'm not the most technologically savvy person. They use acronyms and words I don't know, you know, but I don't play video games, but I made myself interested today. So anyway, well, thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, 40, just look on the website.
And they'll be on.
Yeah, I'd love to see it. And I'll have you on Maine Calling.
Sounds good. Really good.
There you go. Anything else, you guys? Is there anything?
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, let's go. Oh, do I have a question? No?
Yeah. No, am I? Yeah, go ahead.
I have a lot of questions. We hear a lot of talk about the lack of civility in society now.
Yeah.
What, if anything, can you as an interviewer do to help address that?
Well, I just try to be civil on my own program, you know, and I don't, I try to be really firmly, I have one program a day in Maine, and I can do my best I can with my program.
Do you want to name the issue and deal with it as a topic?
A civility? Yeah, I mean, I think that'd be a great topic. We've done fake news. We've talked. I don't think we've done a show just on civility, but we've done shows in which we've discussed the lack of civility. In fact, we just did that. We do a month in review program with journalists, and that was a part of the discussion. Just
there's several groups in Portland working on that very issue.
Yeah, it's a good topic.
But can I just add that you walk the walk. You act in a very civil way, and the change starts with you when you demonstrate that.
Yeah, thank you. It's just my style and what I believe in, and you know, I'm sort of raging. It's my own silent protest of just, maybe not silent protest, but I'm not going to be one of them. I'm not going to yell. I'm not going to call people names, you know. Thank you.
As a woman in the public eye and being a journalist, what are some of the issues that you faced and how did you handle them in terms of sexism or not being looked at as, you know, up there, speak like a lady as an example?
Yeah, no, nobody ever told me that. I read that. That was before my day.
But I bet you have had some experiences.
I've been really, really lucky. My first job in a TV newsroom was in San Francisco. In a very, very progressive, diverse television newsroom, first television station in the country to have a web page. I haven't faced anything overt. I'm one of those people I feel as though I can name a few times in my career where I'm not sure somebody would have talked to me the way they would. They would talk to a man differently than they talk to me. But I haven't had some of the experiences women in maybe even 10 years older than I have had in this business. So
has it changed?
Since the women before me? Oh, I think a lot. It's changed a great deal. Sure. I was told when I was in my young 20s, that I was going to have to make a choice. I was going to have to, if I wanted to be a broadcast journalist, I wasn't going to like get married and have kids. That I had to choose. The reality was, and I had women who were older told me, the reality is you have to make a choice. You can't do both, not in this business. And I remember even then thinking, well, just watch me, you know? And sure, I'm not a network correspondent. I'm not a national public radio. I'm not jetting around the world. But I have a beautiful family, and, you know, I cook dinner. I put dinner in the crock pot this morning, and I went to work, and I've done it, you know. And I don't know if I could have done it if I were the generation ahead of me. I think those women had to really, really, really work hard and work crazy, brutal hours to prove themselves. I'm grateful they paved the path for my generation of women to have it much better. So, go ahead.
But I've seen what you do. Like, one time when I called in and you had, like, a call-in show with a representative, and I asked a question and he was dismissive. So I just hung up, and then you said, well, you didn't answer the question. What would you, and then you rephrase the question.
Yeah.
So there's a little bit of what you do is really strong.
Yeah, well, that and that's what I said on my piece of paper, to really listen. So I think what happens a lot when you're doing an interview show is that, and I've found myself doing this, you're so focused on coming up with the next question that you forget to listen to what the next, you know, you ask a question, the person starts to answer, and then you start thinking, what am I going to ask next? Instead of just listening. But you asked a question, and I was listening for the answer, and the person didn't give the answer, so I repeated the question. But if I weren't listening, I wouldn't have caught that. And I have to say, I'm not perfect that way, because I've got a lot coming at me, because I've got a screen that's got the list of calls, and I've got another, the bottom of the screen is the emails and texts coming in and tweets coming in. And so I'm kind of watching things and trying to listen at the same time. So I'm not perfect. There are times when I probably ought to ask a follow-up question, but I'm sort of focusing on, you know, that email that just came in, and should I ask that, or is it, you know, but when I was doing television and it was just the two of us, you know, you really, really, and Diane Rehm says that when people ask her what her secret is, she says it's to listen, really pay attention to what people are saying, and then go with your gut and follow up. You know, there are limitations though. You know, if you're coming up to a break, if you want to cover a broad, you know, you're often making this choice of, gee, I want to follow up on that question, but I also want to get to these four other things, and I only have this much time left. So you're sometimes always making this call of, should I ask the follow-up question, or just let it go and ask the next question because I want to get to this topic too, you know? And you just got to sort of do your best at that moment, you know? So what are your guys' biggest problems with guests? What are your biggest issues? They ramble?
Yeah. So if they're used to being interviewed, they kind of almost take it over it.
Yeah, jump in.
Yeah. I requested an interview with somebody from my hometown, which is kind of isolated and out of the middle of nowhere. And he had his PR person write me back and ask me what kind of experience I had interviewing musicians. Yeah, and we're from a very small town on the east coast of Newfoundland, like in Canada. So I don't know if it was like...
Is he a really big deal?
In his mind, yes. But he's just like a local kid that kind of made it big, and he's going to be in Maine for 2 days doing concerts. And like it fits in, he's starting a mental health organization back home, and I do a show about mental health.
Right.
It's like, but what different... And I said, well, I'm actually better with hockey players. Does he want to do it on skates? Like, so... That was a big, like, that's the issue that I get sometimes. I've had interviews turned down because...
Do you know his direct address? Can you go around as PR person?
I've done him on Twitter and said, hey, want to do an interview when you're in town? And he said, get in touch with my... And so the email went to his PR person. I thought it was him directly, but he kind of... Like, I've been doing it for years, and I've interviewed musicians, but it wasn't related to music. So it was kind of like,
Sometimes
it's a credibility question. Like, I know I can do it. I know his songs. Like, do I have to sing his songs? Like, I'm not going to ask about that.
Yeah,
they didn't ask what I was going to ask. It was just have you done musicians before?
Yeah. It sounds like a litmus test, and if you didn't give the right answer, then you were just poo-pooed away.
Yeah.
But that was, like, but I've run into that a few times with different organizations who were checking credibility. And it's like,
that's interesting. Yeah, and see, I've always worked for a... You know, I've always worked, this is Jennifer Rooks with Maine Public Radio, so I haven't had to do that. You know, I think you just have to do the best you can and say, what do you know about the audience for community television? And, you know, you can say...
So that might have, they don't really have public television in Canada.
Yeah,
so.
You can say our community television station reaches this many people. The show will broadcast three times.
You go back again and try again with credibility.
Here's what I can tell you about my program. I host a show on mental health on Portland's community television station. We have an audience of this, many people. And if he says no, he says no. You know?
I feel like if I could get in touch with him, it'd be different.
Right, right.
The PR person is like, you know, someone in mainland Canada that...
Is he performing right here, either at the State or Port City Music Hall or somewhere like that?
Brunswick and some other place.
If he's at Port City Music Hall, you could say, our studio is literally one block from where you're performing.
Yeah, he's just even coming into the studio to do an interview in here, and I thought that might kind of sway him, but anyway.
Yeah, no, sometimes people just don't do it. But the flip side of that is sometimes people do. You never know who's going to say yes, so...
Can I just say
I've been surprised both
public television.
But I've been surprised both ways. I've been surprised when people say no, and I've been surprised when people say yes. So
you still keep asking.
Oh yeah, that never hurts to ask. Yeah. Go ahead.
I used to do an interview show where most of my guests were political organizers and activists. And almost every question was as if I pushed a button for a political speech.
Yeah.
And to get, to just change the tempo to what you were describing, a much shorter back and forth, I really had to work at it.
Yeah, it's not easy. It's not easy. Go ahead.
Jennifer, I was just going to ask you, in regards to like really sensitive topics like... I loved your show about the Muslim community, and I had no idea there were 7 mosques in Maine. And I really loved that show for the informational part of it. But in regards to like Matthew, transgender rights, or the Muslim community, do you ever find it challenging that like personally you really want to sort of validate and protect the people that you're interviewing, but you also have to sort of be objective, and do you ever feel?
Yeah, sure. And also, when I'm interviewing people, when I don't live in that community, I'm worried that I'm going to say something offensive without meaning to. But I think people, again, if you're really sort of, like I said, transparent about how you do your show, if you're really upfront about who you are, I think people don't take it that way, even if you ask something. And it's all in the tone, you know. There's so many questions you can ask. Somebody asked it, it'd be offensive, and somebody else asked it, and you just, like, laugh because it sounded so funny the way they asked it, you know. But sure, I really do. I worry about that, especially with sensitive topics, yeah. Absolutely. I think you wouldn't be a human being if you wouldn't, that wouldn't be good if you didn't worry about that kind of thing.
It's hard. Sure, there's a lot of pressure to get those juicy sound bites, but also hold space for the people to say
I don't have to worry about scientific sound bites anymore.
Ah.
Yeah, that was the old Jennifer that did Daily News. I had to get good sound bites. But again, even if it's a sensitive topic, if you guys are doing field reporting where you're going to be cutting and pasting, and whether it's a documentary or a 2-minute news piece, is a great question. Like, what do you mean by that? You know, I had a roommate, I worked in Monterey, California, who would ask the same question like 5 times because she just wants somebody to say it really well. And she's an anchor in Los Angeles right now, so she did well. I think about things a lot. But I think people know I'm a nice person. I'm trying my best, and even if I ask something really dumb, they are not, or if they don't, they act like they're not offended at least. Maybe they really are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah. Thanks.